In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And a very warm welcome to you all to this live stream Mass for Sunday, the fourth Sunday of Advent. We come as Advent goes on and on as we hear the message of the angel Gabriel to Mary at the Annunciation. And as we enter in London, the southeast, into this tier four, so we hear that message, do not be afraid, those most often words quoted in the whole corpus of Scripture. We have done what was wrong in the Lord's sight and chosen what displeases him. Yet as a mother comforts her child, so shall the Lord comfort us. So let us come to him who knows our every deed and thought. Heavenly Father, you exalted the humble and meek. Give us humble and contrite hearts. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you grew towards birth in the Virgin's womb. Be planted also in our hearts and lives. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Holy Spirit, you overshadowed Mary that she might become the God-bearer. Fill us with your heavenly gifts. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who in Jesus Christ has given us a kingdom that cannot be shaken, forgive you your sins. Open your eyes to God's truth. Strengthen you to do God's will. And give you the joy of his kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. God, our Redeemer, who prepared the Blessed Virgin Mary to be mother of your Son, grant that as she looked for his coming as our Saviour, so we may be ready to greet him when he comes again as our Judge, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So we come now to our readings from Scripture, which are read by people from home, our first by Councillor Flick Ray, our second by Ariana in year six of Emmanuel School. And then Father Andy will read our gospel before preaching for us. And you can follow the readings on the email that went out, the link for Sunday readings for December.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. Now when David the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. But I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now therefore, you must say to my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place, and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The response: truly, the Lord is our shield. Truly, the Lord is our shield. My song shall be always of the loving kindness of the Lord. With my mouth will I proclaim your faithfulness throughout all generations. I will declare that your love is established forever. You have set your faithfulness as firm as the heavens. Truly, the Lord is our shield. For you said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn an oath to David, my servant. Your seed will I establish forever and build up your throne for all generations. Truly, the Lord is our shield. You spoke once in a vision and said to your faithful people, I have set a youth above the Almighty. I have raised a young man over the people. I have found David, my servant. With my holy oil have I anointed him. Truly, the Lord is our shield. My hand shall hold him fast, and my arm shall strengthen him. No enemy shall deceive him, nor any wicked person afflict him. I will strike down his foes before his face and beat down those that hate me. Truly, the Lord is our shield. My truth also and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his head be exalted. I will set his dominion over the sea and his right hand upon the rivers. He shall call to me, you are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. Truly, the Lord is our shield.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Romans. To God, who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages but is now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight, and all flesh shall see the salvation of our God. Alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, Greetings, favoured one, the Lord is with you. But she was much perplexed by his words, and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, How can this be, since I am a virgin? The angel said to her, The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her, who was said to be barren, for nothing will be impossible with God. Then Mary said, "Here I am, a servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May my lips speak the truth of the one holy, undivided Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As we prepare to celebrate Christmas in a few days' time, today, on the fourth Sunday of Advent, we remember the Virgin Mary and celebrate her faith, her devotion, and her obedience in answering the call of God to be the mother of a baby who would be God incarnate. Throughout Advent, we have heard of God's promise to send a Saviour into the world, and today we catch a glimpse of how that is to be accomplished. The news that someone is still a baby is nearly always good news. I remember on both occasions when Katie, my wife, and I found out that she was pregnant, we were filled with absolute joy and anticipation. It was a fantastic feeling, but at the same time, it was also somewhat frightening, especially with our firstborn. Although I was married, in a job, and had a house, the fear was still there within me. Would I be able to cope? Would I be able to look after a little baby? Incredibly, at that time, I'd never even held a baby. So although there was excitement and anticipation, there was also fear and trepidation. And if that's how I felt with the sort of situation I was in, just think how Mary must have felt. In all likelihood, she was a teenage girl from a poor family, engaged to be married to Joseph. Her life was mapped out for her. She would marry, settle down in Nazareth while Joseph developed his trade as a carpenter, while she raised the children they had together. This was to be a life like many others in the world at that time, and like many others have been in the world since. But Mary's life was going to be anything but ordinary. In fact, it was to be extraordinary. When the angel Gabriel came to visit her, he informed her that she was going to become a mother. This must have been a major shock to Mary, who, not yet married to Joseph, was still a virgin. But an even bigger shock was revealed to her. The angel revealed that she had found favour with God, and that she was going to be the mother of the Son of God. She was going to be the one who would enable the fulfilment of God's prophecies to Israel. Today's Old Testament reading speaks of one of those prophecies, and is about the preparations that God would make one day for his Son to be born among us, and as one of us. In the reading, King David says that he wishes to build a house for God as a way to give thanks to God for all the blessings he'd received from him. In the history of Israel, God's presence had been manifested in the Ark of the Covenant, the sacred wooden box which contained the two stone tablets given to Moses. This was carried by the Israelites in their travels and in their battles as a reminder that God was with them, and it was kept in a sacred tent. In the first reading, we hear how King David was concerned that the Ark of God dwelt in a tent, while he himself lived in a house made of wood. And because of that, he was considering the idea of building a temple where the Ark of God would be kept. So he told the prophet Nathan of his plan to build a house for it. But God revealed to Nathan that he didn't want such a dwelling, and instead told him to tell David that he instead would establish a house for David. And God's promise to David was a spectacular one. "The Lord declares to you, David," he said, "that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." In other words, he was telling him that he would have a dynasty that would be eternal. In later generations, this prophecy would become the bedrock of Jewish messianic hope, sustaining them at times when their very existence seemed threatened. And today's first reading also provides the Old Testament background to today's Gospel reading by telling the story of how it came about that God promised to David an eternal kingdom. It's a scene setter for what's to follow in Luke's narrative of the Annunciation. In this, the angel Gabriel tells Mary that she has found favour with God, and announces the divine identity of a child whom Mary is about to conceive through the power of the Holy Spirit. In the infancy narrative, we see our Saint Luke wish to indicate the divine origin of Jesus, as well as to show how his birth was a fulfillment of Old Testament prophecies and expectations, and in particular, that in today's reading, we see the fulfillment of the promise made by God to King David in the message the angel Gabriel gave to Mary. In it, we hear of Gabriel appearing to a young girl in Nazareth, the Virgin Mary, who was engaged to a man named Joseph, who belonged to the house of David. The angel greeted her with the words, "Greetings, favoured one, the Lord is with you." The first thing we should notice here is that the initiative for the whole event comes from God, and all that happens to Mary comes as a pure gift from God, because she has found favour with him. We're also given the clues that this is not going to be like anything which had traditionally been associated with the coming of the Messiah. The woman chosen for God's great work is a very young, unsuspecting virgin who comes from a town not even mentioned in the Old Testament. She was engaged to be married to Joseph, yet God had another plan for her. Indeed, as is often the case, that's the way God works in the world and in our lives. The angel's statement that the Lord was with Mary signifies that the Messianic age had dawned and implies a special position of importance for her. Much more than God's presence with King David, the Lord is literally with Mary. She is to be the Ark of the New Covenant, the home of God, this time not a tent or a temple, but instead a human being. It's absolutely no wonder then that this young girl was initially very troubled by what she was being told by the angel. But Gabriel understood her concern and reassured her by saying, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God." He then continued with a promise, "And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary's child is to be the heir to the promises made to David, but his will be a dynasty that surpasses every human expectation. Furthermore, St. Luke's statements regarding Mary's virginity underline the divine, miraculous character of this birth and of the centrality of Jesus Christ by revealing during the Annunciation the unique character of a child Mary will give birth to and his true identity as the Messiah and the Son of God. And in all this, Mary has the new dignity in that she has been chosen to become the Mother of God. But for Mary, the circumstances were hardly reassuring. She realises that, humanly speaking, it makes no sense at all. She has not been with a man, so she asks for clarification as to how it all would happen. The angel's response is that all of this would be accomplished by the Holy Spirit. Just as the Spirit was present at the first creation, so the Spirit will now bring about the new creation within Mary. With little else to go on but the word of the angel Gabriel, Mary freely accepted the fact that she had been chosen to be the mother of the Messiah and surrendered herself to the will of God. Mary listened and humbly answered the invitation by saying, "Here I am, a servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Just as God had freely chosen to give, so Mary had also freely chosen to accept. And with her unhesitating yes, Mary changed the course of our salvation forever. Through Mary, God became one of us. Through Mary, God became present among us. So as we stand on the threshold of Christmas, let Mary be a model for us. Let us follow her example of faith and holiness, of humility and simplicity, of obedience and surrender to the will of God, as we await the coming of our Saviour into the world and into our lives. Amen.
So he celebrates the wonder, the hope, and the joy of our faith, a faith shared with Christians throughout the world and down the ages, in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. So in the power of the Spirit, in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Compassionate and faithful God, as we hear that account of the appearance of the able angel Gabriel to Mary, giving her her high and unparalleled vocation that she might be the God-bearer. So we pray for us in the circumstances of our own lives that we may be God-bearers in our own generation. As we pray for all who lead in the Church, we pray for Justin, our Archbishop, in our diocese. We pray for Sarah, our bishop, for Robert, our area bishop. We pray for our partner dioceses of Angola, Mozambique, and New York, and our own partner parishes, St. Michael's and West 99th Street, Manhattan, for Mother Kate and all the people there. We pray for our sister parishes, St. Cuthbert's, and indeed for all the churches and chaplaincies of this deanery of Camden. And as always, we pray for our sister and brother Christians suffering persecution the world over, for light and hope in their darkness. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Father, your prophet of old foretold that your Son would be mighty God and Prince of Peace. We pray for that same peace may spread mightily abroad in our world of today, bringing about an end to violence, hatred, warfare, discrimination and prejudice. We ask your gifts of wisdom and discernment for all world leaders, especially Elizabeth, our Queen, and all in authority under her, for our Prime Minister and our government, for Tulip, our Member of Parliament, for our ward councillors and these wards of Fortune Green and West Hampstead, for Georgia, the leader of our council, for Maryam, our Mayor. We pray for those parts of the world that do not have the same democracy that we most take for granted. We pray for all parts of the world suffering natural disasters of flood and famine, and for all who seek to bring them relief, for Christian Aid and CAFOD. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We pray for this community which we serve, giving thanks for the West Hampstead Food Hub, the over 100 households who receive food parcels today, for all volunteers. We pray for Sidings Community Centre, where it's situated, for West Hampstead Community Centre. We continue to pray for the work of the local COVID-19 mutual help organisations in this area as we enter Tier 4. We pray for our schools as they begin their Christmas holidays, for Miss Fitzsimmons as she leaves for a new job. And as always, we pray for Nazanin as she continues under house arrest in Iran, for her swift and her safe release. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. So we pray for the sick and the suffering, whether in mind, body, or spirit, giving thanks for the work of all doctors, nurses, healthcare, and key workers, for scientists who research a vaccine. We pray for any who are vulnerable and isolating at home, as well as all those others on our parish prayer list, praying for John, Pete, Jenny, Gerald, Betty, France, Natasha, Rome, Rachel, Dorothy, Betsy, India, Pascal, Richard, Tessa, Nancy, Desiree, Bishop Alexander and Shami, James, Mrs. Luke and Mrs. Mason, Father Alan, Felicity, Maria, Eva, Sundarshan, Gerard, Di, Zara, Neusta, Deborah, Ivan, Alison, Pam, Isabel, and family, and all those known to us personally. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. And of your charity, pray for the souls of the departed. Amongst the recently departed, for the souls of David Goodall, Clary Mendy, Alan Hitchin, Joyce Hall, and Henry. For those who mourn their loss. So too we pray for those we have known and loved who have died in past years, those who have helped us on our own life's journey and taught us of your love. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. May they rest in peace and rise in glory, and may their memories be a blessing. And finally, in a few moments' silence, we offer our own prayers, intentions and thanksgivings before the throne of grace. Rejoicing in the fellowship of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all your saints, we commend ourselves, all for whom we pray, and the whole creation to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. In the tender mercy of our God, the dayspring from on high shall break upon us, to give light to those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace be with you all. So now as we prepare the altar at the offertory, we hear the words of the hymn, longing for light, we wait in darkness. Christ be our light, light in the darkness of the world. If you'd like to give to the online collection, you can do so through the homepage of the parish website. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. O come, Emmanuel. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the true vine and living bread. Come, Christ our Saviour, come to the world which waits for you. You who are alive and reign, both now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God and everlasting Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son. He is the one foretold by all the prophets, whom the Virgin Mother bore with love beyond all telling. John the Baptist was his herald and made him known when at last he came. In his love, Christ fills us with joy as we prepare to celebrate his birth, so that when he comes again, he may find us watching in prayer, our hearts filled with wonder and praise. And so with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your glory and join in their unending hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death upon the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the God-bearer, the apostles, the martyrs, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Awaiting his coming in glory, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. This mingling of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to us who receive it. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Behold Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. It's an opportunity to avail yourself of an act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you are already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. He gives me purity of heart, giving me healing and strength now and forever. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, who chose the Blessed Virgin Mary to be the mother of the promised Saviour, fill us, your servants, with your grace, that in all things we may embrace your holy will, and with her rejoice in your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, I thank you most warmly for joining us for this live stream Mass tonight. With the Prime Minister's announcement that we're in Tier 4 in London and the South East, we're going to play very carefully our communal worship services, because at the moment the Prime Minister has said that these can continue to go ahead as if they're in COVID-secure environments, which of course we are here at Emmanuel, but we are very much attentive to that advice and guidance that we should try and stay home wherever possible. Whatever happens over this Christmas period, you can be sure to follow all the services and the liturgies of these last days of Advent leading up to the birth of Jesus at Christmas on our live stream, both here on Facebook and on YouTube also. If anything changes before tomorrow, we will put this on our parish website and also send out an email to the MailChimp list. The Lord be with you. Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you, scatter the darkness from before your path, and make you ready to meet him when he comes in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, come down upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.